Bye-bye. Good morning and happy Mother's Day. We're going to worship today. We're going to be a little bit playful today. We're going to think of our mothers and the mother type people in our life. Let's see, I don't have announcements since we aren't doing many things except worship. We are continuing with the Bible study every other week. Excuse me. And so not today, but next week, we will meet at 11:15 and we'll start looking at the book of Job, which is a very fascinating book. Feel free to join us next week. In the All Church email that I sent out yesterday, I said, and I will lift up again, both our denominations strongly urge us not to open our churches for worship at this time. So we are just hanging in there with this kind of worship, and I will be glad to be done with this kind of worship and actually see your faces and know who you are. But for now, this is how we're going to do it. So let's worship. We're going to think about mothers, and we're going to think about hats today, and we're going to think about the risen Christ. Let's pray. Generous, good, and gracious God, we dedicate our hearts and our lives to you. Help us to cherish all life, the people we love, the people we find it hard to love, the plants, the animals, the earth. Help us to cherish all life and to do the good that you would want us to do, and to serve the people that you give to us to serve. Lord, help us to model your generous love and to be a blessing to everyone we see. Guide us so that your spirit is in all we think and all we say and all we do. Amen. Our first scripture reading is from the book of 1 Peter. And we're talking in the service today about identity, about who gets to decide who we are and how we act. And that's we're talking about us as individuals and also us as a church community. And so this scripture refers to our defining who we are as a church community. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you might proclaim the mighty acts of the one who called you out of darkness and into the marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. So it's Mother's Day, and I expect that Mother's Day may be a little different this year than it is some years for your family. Let's lift up in a prayerful spirit. Let's lift up some of the mothers and mother type people in our life, and I'll name some, and you, in the moment of silence that follows, you give thanks or hold into the light or remember some of the people in your life. Your own mother, of course. And the mother type figures, people who have been like a mother to you. And we know that not all mothers are the kind of mothers we needed. And we lift those mothers up, those who struggled, those who could not give us, for whatever reason, the care or the love that we needed. We give thanks for grandmothers, for mothers waiting to give birth. For mothers who want a child but cannot have one. For single mothers. For mothers who have lost a child. For mothers who raise their children in war situations or in poverty. And for tired mothers. Let's pray. Holy God, we thank you for the mothers and the mother type people who have loved us and guided us. As best we are able, we forgive those mothers who were not able to be the kind of mothers that we needed. We thank you that you are like a mother to us with your unconditional love. We thank you that from mothers and men who can be nurturing and compassionate and caring, like we think of mothers as being, we thank you for all the people in our life who offer us that kind of love and care. And may we be ourselves those kind of people. Amen. Okay, kids, I need you to get a hat. I need you to leave here and get a hat. And the grown-ups are too stuffy to do silly things. So I need you to persuade the grown-ups in the room with you to get a hat also. And don't wear the hat yet, just hold it. But come back real quick with a hat. I have a hat here. It used to belong to my dad. And so I'm ready with my hat. So you go find the hat. We will just hum or something while we give you a few seconds to come up with a hat. The gospel that I'm going to read is also about identity, about Jesus knowing who he was. Other people had many different ideas on who Jesus was or should be, but he knew who he was and he lived out of that knowledge. And so this is from the fourth chapter of the Gospel of Luke. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread throughout the countryside. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. And when he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, and to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And Jesus rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down, and the eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. And then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him, and they were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. And then they said, "Isn't this Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, heal yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here in your hometown the things that we have heard you did at Capernaum.' And Jesus said, 'Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel at the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up for 3 years and 6 months, and there was a severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them, except a widow at Zephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them were cleansed except Naaman the Syrian. When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of town, and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. Okay, I need you to put on your hat. This might cover the fact that I'm 2 months overdue for a haircut. How about you? Okay. And I have a story. This story is a shortened version of Miss Honeycutt's Hat by Jeff Brombo and Gail DeMarkin. One fine day in the town of Littleton, everyone was as busy as could be. The Queen was taking a trip, and she would pass right through Littleton promptly at 3 o'clock. No one thought the Queen would stop in a little town like Littleton because it was, well, too little. But just in case, they'd be ready. They were scurrying to paint the cottages purple, the Queen's favorite color. They were sweeping the streets and wearing the very best of their best. All except for timid Miss Honeycutt. She always did her shopping on Tuesdays at 3 o'clock. She usually did not make a fuss, but today she decided to put her foot down. Queen or no queen, she was going shopping, and she would wear her new hat from Paris, even though it was a little, different. Just before 3 o'clock, she stepped outside looking much the same as always, except there was something different. That was her hat. It looked quite like the hats the other ladies wore. It was blue with ribbons and some feathers. But what was different was that this hat had chicken feathers. And the feathers were still stuck to the chicken, who was happily clucking away on Miss Honeycutt's head. Just then, Mrs. McSnoot came marching by. "Why, Miss Honeycutt, what on earth is that on your head?" "It's my new blue hat all the way from Paris. I do hope you like it."
"It's horrible. It's terrible. It's a chicken. You can't wear a chicken on your head."
"Well, why? Why is that?"
"What will the Queen think? Take it off this instant."
"I just don't know," Miss Honeycutt said in a tiny voice. "I think I might have the right to wear what I like. And I won't wear a lobster, and I won't wear a weasel, but I would like to wear a chicken, and I'd like to wear it on my head." Well, Mrs. McSnoot poked at the chicken, and the chicken bit her finger, and the noise Mrs. McSnoot made caused Miss Bisbee's 27 cats to run up the apple tree, and someone called the fire department to get the cats out of the tree. And Miss Wimple, who was taking a bath, thought when she heard the fire siren that her house was on fire, and so she wrapped the shower curtain around herself and leaped out of the window into the fire chief's arms. But Miss Wimple had forgotten to turn off the bath water, and she jumped before she jumped, and pretty soon water rushed out of her house and into the street, and everything got muddy, and everybody got muddy, and the Queen was due any minute. And here came the baker's truck with the 12-foot-high cake. And from the other direction, here came the truck with the raspberry soda. Each driver was so surprised to see a woman with a chicken on her head that they forgot to look where they were going. And the trucks slid in the mud and slid into each other. Cake and soda flew up in the air and came down all over the Littletonians.
"What will the Queen think? She'll be here any second. It's your fault, Miss Honeycutt. Take off your hat."
And Miss Honeycutt said a little less timidly, I don't think I should. I'm pretty sure I have the right to wear what I like. And I won't wear a rhinoceros, and I won't wear a poodle.
but I'd like to wear a chicken and wear it on my head. Just then, Mayor McTwaddle waddled over. What's going on here? Look at her hat. That mess would never have happened if she hadn't put on that horrible thing. Now, Miss Honeycutt, said the mayor, we can't have your hat laying eggs when the queen comes by now, can we? That wouldn't do at all. As the royal mayor of Littleton, I must demand you remove your hat this instant. Miss Honeycutt answered politely but firmly, I will not. I won't wear a flounder, and I won't wear an orangutan, but I will wear a chicken, and I will wear it on my head. Just then the courthouse clock struck three, and a child called down from the tower, here she comes, here comes the queen. Everyone waved and hurrayed and hurrahed as the longest, shiniest automobile anyone had ever seen whooshed down Main Street. And just when they thought the queen was going to whisk right by, the auto suddenly stopped. The queen marched past the mayor. She marched past Mrs. McSnoot and the baker and the 27 cats and everyone else until she stood in front of Miss Honeycutt. The crowd wondered how the queen would punish Miss Honeycutt for wearing such a hat. A minute passed, and the queen clapped her hands three times. The royal guards ran to the auto and then returned carrying the queen's hat. It was red with yellow ribbons and pink roses. There was a little bow in front, and on top was a gobbling turkey. The queen spoke to Miss Honeycutt. My dear, what a glorious hat. Would you care to trade? Miss Honeycutt looked the queen right in the eye and said, I have a right to wear what I like, and I won't wear a platypus, and I won't wear a wombat. But now that I think of it, I might wear a turkey. I just might wear it on my head. They each placed their new hats on their heads just so. And then the queen said, I'm having a little bash for the usual kings and queens of the world. Why don't you pop by? And then two new friends walked arm in arm to the longest, shiniest automobile anyone had ever seen. In the months that followed, first 10, and then 22, and then all the ladies of Littleton were seen wearing chicken hats of their own. Life settled back to normal. And then one day, Miss Honeycutt stepped outside her door to do her 3 o'clock shopping. She looked the same as always, except today she wore a new hat that had come all the way from Bombay. It was green with pink ribbons and bows all about. And on top, looking quite handsome, was a very pleased and grinning porcupine. Poor Miss Honeycutt. She didn't ask for trouble. She was no rabble rouser. She was rather timid, really. The only thing unique about her was her hat. No, actually, there was one other thing unique about her. Miss Honeycutt would not let others define who she would be. This is a playful story, one of my favorites, but under its silliness is a serious issue. Who gets to define who we will be? That question marks a place of deep struggle at some point in our life for all of us. Think about it. Who has tried to define sometime in your life, who has tried to define who you will be or how you will act? Parents can do that. You'll go into the family business, of course, or you're going to be this religion and not that one. Or this is how you'll wear your hair, or raise your kids, or keep your house. Our culture and corporate America can try to define who we will be also. You'll be one of the ones who believes that violence is the answer. You'll be someone who thinks that you never have enough. Even our friends, our peer group, can try to decide who will be expecting us to criticize whom they criticize and vote the way they vote. Can you think of a time in your life when someone else tried to define who and how you would be? When we look at the life of Jesus, we see that people were always trying to define him. The Pharisees wanted him to be a traditional religious person in the style that they were. The disciples wanted him to play it safe. The needy crowds wanted him to care for them 24/7. His family wanted him to come home and just be a good boy. And Miss Honeycutt's neighbors wanted her to be like them and leave her chicken hat at home. So who gets to define who we're going to be? That's not an easy question to answer. We can so easily be swayed by the voices around us. We can believe we're defining ourselves when in fact it is the culture or the media or the peer group or voices from our past defining us. For instance, Becky was asked to be in the church choir, but she won't sing. Years ago, a music teacher had made a negative comment about Becky's singing voice, and all these years later, she still believes that she sings off tune, although in fact, she sings quite nicely. Becky has let the music teacher define who she is. And there's Karen's husband who handled the money and finances. He told Karen many times she wasn't smart enough to do it. And over time, she came to believe him. After his death, she had no choice but to handle finances. And she discovered to her surprise that she did it very well. She wondered why she had, for so many years, let someone else define who she was and what she was capable of doing. I remember a seminary professor who told us the story about himself. He said that when he was a new church pastor, he had a dream in this particular church of some ministry for youth. But the church was not open to new things, and they had already said no to several previous dreams that he had brought to their attention. So he decided not to ask permission. He decided just to start making that youth ministry happen. He said to us, "I decided just to run with it until someone stopped me." No one ever did. The question was not for him, who is going to let me? The question was, who is going to stop me? He was not going to let others decide who he was and what he could do. As a people who have chosen to follow the way of Jesus, our faith reminds us who we are. We are sons and daughters of God. We are made in God's image. We are temples of the Holy Spirit. We carry the risen Christ within us. And as a church community, we know who we are. The writer of 1 Peter describes it. We are a chosen race, a holy nation, God's own people, people who know God's mercy. We are part of the body of Christ. And that means that we act one way and not another. It means we shape our lives around love and forgiveness and not around hatred and judgment. The only person we are destined to become is the person that we have decided to be. That's some of what faith is about, and surely that's a lot of what baptism is about. It's about helping us to know clearly who we are. We will not be who the culture says we will be. We will not let society determine how we will act. We will not let the media choose our values for us or make our choices for us. We will not abdicate that right and privilege even to our friends and family. One woman was always polite and friendly to the man in the drive-thru where she would pick up a cup of coffee on her way to work every morning. But the clerk was always surly and rude to her. One day a friend said to the woman, why do you continue to be so polite to him when he is so obnoxious? And she answered, "Why should I let him define how I'm going to act?" I like this quote from a rabbi whose name was Zusia. He says, when my life on this earth ends and I face the celestial tribunal, I shall not be asked why I was not Abraham, or why I was not Joseph, or Jacob, or why I was not Moses. I shall be asked why I was not Zusia. One of the chief causes of happiness is to be a person who is willing to be what he is and not what others think he should be. Be yourself. Everybody else is already taken. I think about people who have refused to be defined by others. They are beautiful and powerful people. Rosa Parks lived in a world that intended to define her. She was black, and her world made that fact about her skin color an essential part of her definition. She was to be timid and subservient. She was supposed to know her place. Well, she did know her place at the front of the bus. She got tired of the world telling her who she was. Nelson Mandela was unjustly imprisoned for 28 years. The culture told him who and how he was supposed to be. He was supposed to be bitter and angry and vengeful, but he had his own idea of who he was. And when he was released from prison, he came out of 28 years of hell speaking forgiveness to power. Antoinette Brown in the mid-1800s wanted to be a minister. Her culture told her that women couldn't do that. She challenged one obstacle after another and finally became the first woman to be ordained into Christian ministry. She wasn't willing to let others tell her who she could be. Even Robert E. Lee refused to let others define him. After his defeat in the Civil War, someone asked him if they could use his name in a business venture. General Lee answered, "My good name is about all I have left from this terrible tragedy. And it is not for sale." Lee decided for himself who he was. And then, of course, there's Jesus. He knew who he was. He learned it at his baptism when the voice said, "This is my beloved son." Every choice he would have to make for the rest of his life would be held up against that knowing he was God's beloved son. One day he came to his hometown to preach, and he reads a passage from Isaiah. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Jesus identified himself with these words. He knew who he was. He was a beloved son of God. He was one called by God to serve, and he lived that identity with integrity. He knew who he was. Many people or forces will try to define us. Some want us to buy more. Some want us to hate the ones they hate. Some want us to make our comfort a priority over another's need. Some want us to sacrifice our integrity. Don't give them the right to decide who you are. God has already done that. God has already named who you are. You are part of the body of Christ. You are a temple of the Holy Spirit. You are God's beloved. That's who you are. Don't let anyone define you as anything less. Don't let yourself settle for anything less, though less will always be easier. Remember Rosa Parks and Robert E. Lee. Remember Nelson Mandela and Antoinette Brown. Remember Jesus. Remember Miss Honeycutt's hat. Let's be in silence.
Let's be in prayer. Holy One, give us the strength it takes to listen rather than to judge, to trust rather than to fear, to try again and again to make peace even when peace eludes us. We ask, O God, for the grace to be our best selves. We ask for the vision to be builders of the human community rather than its destroyers. We ask for the humility as a people to understand the fears and hopes of other peoples. For you, O God, have been merciful to us. You, O God, have been patient with us. You, O God, have been gracious to us, and so may we be merciful and patient and gracious with those others whom you also love. This we ask through our Lord Jesus. Holy One, we give you thanks for the sunshine. The weather's a little bit crazy, but we give you thanks for the sunshine and for the warm days when they come. We give you thanks for the mothers and the mother-type people and the grandmothers and the aunties and the next-door neighbor who came over just when we needed someone. We ask for healing in any of those places where our relationship with the mothers in our lives need some healing. We confess that in the midst of this pandemic, which seems to go on and on and on, many of us are getting stir crazy. We're tired of screens. We can't pretend that Zoom is as good as a real live hug. Grant us the patience and the courage and the trust to make wise choices and live sensibly in this very, very difficult time until more healing happens. We pray for the people in our community and in our families who are struggling with anxiety or depression, who are dealing with an illness, recovering from surgery, who have family struggles or worry about their finances and their businesses and their safety. Thank you for this community, which is together even when we're apart. This community and all the people in our lives who sustain us and support us when things are difficult. And help us to trust your presence and your ability to find new things that we had not even thought of to bring healing and hope. You know the prayers of each of our hearts. We offer them to you, prayers for people we love, prayers for the people we struggle to love, prayers for this community and this nation. And all this we offer to you, knowing, trusting that you hear and that you and your spirit are moving through our world. And together we pray the prayer that we learned from our Lord and our brother. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God be in my head and in my understanding. God be in my eyes and in my looking. God be in my mouth and in my speaking. God be in my heart and in my thinking. God be at my end and at my departing. Go in peace this week. God surrounds you with love. Jesus walks before you so you are not alone, and the Spirit inspires you to do what needs to be done. Don't let anyone else define who you are. That's God's job, and God has done it. You are part of the body of Christ, God's beloved son or daughter. You are loved. Go in peace. See you next week.